Good morning, choir. It's nice to see you there. Look, the Morrow family is here. Yeah, way cool. And all of you are here. I am delighted that you are here. Good morning and welcome. We do not have very many announcements that I'm going to share with you. We have a wedding shower next week, March 18, in the chapel at 1 p.m. Elise is coordinating that, so you can connect with her. And beyond that, I'll let you read the announcements in the bulletin. After church today, we have potluck. Oh, lovely. I like to eat, and some of you like to eat too, and we have really, really good food downstairs, so I hope you will stay for lunch with us. And then after lunch, we will have a screening of another film. This one is called Enough Room at the Table, and it's the distilled essence of a weekend of people who have gotten together to talk about issues of faith and sexuality in the church. It paints a picture of people engaged in intense, respectful dialogue. I hope you can stay for that, and then the time of discussion afterwards. So lunch, whatever you do, you have to stay for lunch. And then since you've stayed for lunch, you might as well stay for the film. And then if you stayed for the film, I know you'll want to be here for the discussion as well. So just before the sermon, I am going to do a little bit more introduction of our weekend guest. But for now, I'll just say, stay for lunch and stay for the film. And at this point, I'm going to invite you to stand, greet one another, pass God's peace here in God's house. Let's pray.
Almighty God, thank you for calling us into your presence, and thank you for receiving us with your smile. Lord of the cosmos, we pray that you will work your wonders and your ways throughout the universe, and especially here in our little corner. Bring about peace, subdue evil, restore harmony. Lord of our hearts, so mold and shape us, so fill us, that in the week to come we may act as agents of your kingdom to bring hope and help and healing. Is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
A portion of today's world budget offering goes toward Adventist World Radio. A good friend of mine works for Adventist World Radio, and she has always been a better writer than I, and I would like to share some of her words with you. Adventist World Radio fills a unique role on the front lines of church outreach. Radio waves carry the gospel to places where church workers would otherwise have a very difficult time entering, and people are listening. From North Africa and Sudan to Bangladesh and China, people are hearing of God's love for the first time through Adventist World Radio's programs, and they are responding with testimonies of transformed lives. One new believer in Ethiopia wrote, "I found your station accidentally. After listening to your programs for the last 2 years, I started going to church. My life is changing gradually. I would like to tell you that many people are listening to your programs. God bless you." Adventist World Radio's programs can be heard in more than 100 languages through shortwave, local AM/FM radio, and podcasts. These broadcasts bypass harsh governments and hostile cultures, bringing hope directly into people's homes and hearts. But there are still millions of listeners who cannot hear the message of salvation in a language they can understand. With your help, Adventist World Radio can add new languages and reach ever further into untouched territories. We invite you today to partner with Adventist World Radio in this vital ministry. Will the deacons please stand? God, we thank you for your abundant love. Thank you that we have the ability to give from our abundance to share the message of your love with the world. Amen.
that in some ways all of us are different, but in some ways all of us have things that are the same. Yeah? Sound a little bit like Daniel Tiger?
We both
You both love Legos? Oh, so Isaac and his sister are alike because they both like Legos. I bet a lot of you guys love Legos.
Yeah.
But in some ways, everybody's different too. You guys have things that are special about you that are different from everybody else that are from this layer.
But I took lots of pieces, we broke it, but then lots of pieces disappeared.
Oh, that's the hard thing about Legos, pieces disappearing. Yeah, that's hard. Yeah, so all of us have things that are alike, but all of us also have special things that make us different. And you know what else? I work with people who stutter, with kids who stutter. Do you know what stuttering is? That's when you have repetitions or tightening in your talking. So it sounds kind of like this. I really am glad to talk to you today. Is that something that's different? Yeah. Is it noticeable? Yeah. And it's something that's hard for them. So all of us have things that are the same and things that are different. And all of us also have things that we're really good at and things that are hard for us. And if you stutter, talking is really hard for you. And so sometimes people make fun of you. Have you ever had anyone make fun of you? Does anyone? I've had people make fun of me. I'm going to share some stories.
Someone teased you.
Oh, yeah. It's hard when people tease you. Is anyone brave, and could they share with us something that they've been teased about?
Yeah, I
can say that. That I was, shorter than other people.
Oh, Ava was teased because she was shorter. Is that something she has control over? No, that's not very nice to pick that out and point that out. Does anyone else have something that they would be brave enough to share that someone teased them about before? It's kind of hard. You can't remember any time? I'm going to share with you guys a couple stories of times that I was teased. My mother is Canadian, so people in Canada say things a little differently than people here in the United States. Like, have you ever heard someone go, "That's right, eh?" Use "eh." That's the most classic Canadian thing. But that is not actually what I did. So because my mother was Canadian, I spoke like a Canadian. And I lived in Utah. And in Utah, they don't sound like Canadians. So one day, I was eating lunch, and I said, this dinner tastes good. Because in Canada, your dinner is your lunch. That's mind-blowing, huh? That's how it was for the other kids that were there, too. They were like, "What?" And this one girl said, "Dinner? That's not dinner. That's lunch." She said dinner. She doesn't even know how to say lunch. And she teased me all lunch. And then she followed me into the library after lunch, and she kept teasing me until I was hiding behind the books. How do you think I felt?
Bad.
Yeah. Was that nice? Was that a nice thing to do?
No.
No. And you know what? Nobody stood up for me. Nobody said, "Hey, back off," or "Stop it, that's not nice." And so I felt like everybody thought that the things that I said were stupid. Because nobody stood up for me, and I was like, everyone's laughing at me. They think saying dinner is really dumb. So that was the first time that I was really teased. And the second time, I was older, and we were all sitting around in a group. And in Utah, almost everybody when I was growing up was Mormon. And so they went to church on Sunday. And when they were talking about going to church, and I said I went to church on Saturday. And one of the girls I was sitting with was like, "You go to church on Saturday? Oh, that's so weird. You're so weird. That's so strange. That's weird." And then my teacher came up and said, "Hey, actually, that's what the Bible says." What do you think she did? Did she keep teasing me? Nope, she went like this. You know why? Because it's harder to tease someone when someone comes up and stands next to them and says, "Hey, I'm with her."
Amen.
So, someone, how does it make you them feel? It kind of makes them feel a little broken inside. It hurts them. Is it easy to break one little stick like this? Can someone... All right, Isaac, you come show me. Can you break one stick like this?
Yeah.
All right, I want you to be careful. These are shabab things or whatever, so they have a little point. All right, break that one thing. See if you can do it. They're very tight. You can almost break it. You got it worn in. All right, we'll have Ava come up and show us. All right, can you break one stick?
Wow.
Oh, you demolished it. All right.
Give it to Ella.
All right. All right, now. See if you can just go like this and see if you can break all those. Just barely too good for you, huh? You can break a few at a time. That's right, but when they all stand together, oh, it's tough. You can't break that. That's hard to do. You want to try that? All right. Oh, it's harder than you thought, huh? They look like little sticks, but oh, when they all stand together. All right. At potluck, you may all try to break the sticks together. I will let you come up and try that. So God tells us that when somebody is being hurt or attacked by someone, that we can stand with them. And that's what justice is doing the right thing and standing with someone who needs you.
So like if someone's standing with the person who's getting bullied, they're kind of like a bundle of sticks.
That's right. If you're standing with someone when they're getting bullied, then they're going to not feel like the world's against them. They're going to be like, no, I can do it. I have other people who are standing with me. And you know what? When I go, I said I work with kids who stutter. We go to their school classes because sometimes they're bullied. People bully them because they can't talk the same way that we talk. They talk in a different way, and it's hard for them. And so when I do those talks, we practice something, because standing up to bullies, is that easy?
No.
No, it's not. One of the hardest things that I've ever done is standing up to bullies when I've done it. It's hard, it's not easy. So you have to take little steps to doing it until you feel confident to stand up even when it's hard. So the first way that we practice is I have the kids imagine that someone's getting bullied and then you say, no. Can you guys do that?
No.
No.
No. So you can always stand next to the person that's getting bullied, but you can also say something. All right, let's try to say it again. I'm going to go 3, 2, 1, and I want you guys to say, no. Okay, ready? 3, 2, 1.
No.
Whoa. You guys are a lot of sticks standing together. That was a lot. All right, we're going to try one more because we're building our muscles at being brave and standing for other people. So we're going to say, stop it. Okay? All right, let's try it. Ready? 3, 2, 1,
stop it!
Whoa! That was great! You know, this reminds me, there's a text in the Bible. We can talk about sticks, but we can also talk about water. Like, each of us is like a little droplet, but when we all get together, we're like a rolling river. And it talks about that in the Bible. In Amos chapter 5, verse 24, it says, but let justice roll on like a river, righteousness, like a never-ending stream.
Amen.
So my prayer for you guys is that you will stand up for justice, that you will help people who are being teased and hurt and vulnerable, okay? Because all of us are alike in some ways, but different in others, and sometimes the ways that we are weak or the ways that we are different aren't obvious to everybody. So we have to help those kids whose differences are more obvious and who are getting teased. Okay. Ellen has a special announcement.
This is a special time because it's our pastor's birthday. And it is a special birthday because it's 65. How many of you guys are 65?
I won't ask the caller.
And I'm not going to ask all of you. But we wanted to memorialize this time. Something that's really impressive that if you haven't known about Pastor John, he loves to hike, and he loves his dog, Rexy. And Shirley and Dawn are to thank for this amazing cake, which if you see the top of it, has Pastor John and Rexy going up a mountain.
So,
I have somebody on my lap. I can't.
Good excuse. I'm a parent. And we have some folks who want to say something about me.
When she was little, she had her own vocabulary. An elephant was an F-a-mump, and she had lots of words. One of them was she wanted to say happy birthday. She had her own way to say it. It was Hattie Durstay to you. And thank you, Pastor John, for being our Hattie Durstay this year.
When Ellen asked me if I would say something in appreciation of what you, again, really represent, both in my life and the community that I work and live in, I realized how much you actually resonate in my life and resonate in the lives of those around me. When people ask, why do you go to church on Saturday, as someone asked, and what it means to me is the community that actually represents the kind of love that we have always sought in the church, and I think that's representative of your authentic leadership and celebrating, and the option to celebrate your birthday here today is just to say thank you for being this authentic leader for this church, and of course being the representative of what it means to be Christian. So thank you.
Amen.
Pastor John does children's story. It's always fun.
Amen. So just two more brief things. And one, of course, we need to sing to you. And then we'll have a blessing.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Pastor. Happy birthday to you.
We're almost done, John, so hold on. At this time, I invite the congregation to please stand and find your little paper that you have on your pew. It's a colored piece of paper. And John, may I ask you to come stand up on the platform just one more time for us to do. And John, I'd like you to just take a quick look around at the faces, including the people in the choir loft, the people who love you and appreciate you. And this is a blessing that Pastor John gives to us week after week. So I invite you to raise your hand as you are comfortable, in the symbol of a blessing, and read this, pray this blessing upon John and his life. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turns his face toward you and give you peace. Amen. You may be seated. All right, kids, you can go get your buckets now and head to your seats. Thank you.
God, each of us comes here today with our own struggles and joys. We pray for those listed in the bulletin that you will give them comfort and hope, and that we will know how we can help to bring them comfort and hope. We praise you for the many joys in life. We come here today with faith, faith that you love each of us and all people with unending, unconditional love. We come with hope, hope for your return when all suffering will end, and hope that until then we will not be overwhelmed with all of the pain and anger and hatred in the world, but will instead find ways to be agents of change. And we come knowing that unless we have love, everything else is as sounding brass and clanging cymbals. May we choose to focus on your love and thus more fully reflect it in our actions. Amen.
The Old Testament reading is from the 13th chapter of Deuteronomy, verses 6 through 10a. Suppose someone secretly entices you, even your brother, your son, or your daughter, your beloved wife, or your closest friend, and says, "Let us go worship other gods, gods that neither you nor your ancestors have known. They might suggest that you worship the gods of peoples who live nearby or who come from the ends of the earth. But do not give in or listen. Have no pity and do not spare or protect them. You must put them to death. Strike the first blow yourself, and then all the people must join in. Stone the guilty ones to death."
Thank you.
The New Testament reading is from Acts 15, verses 4 through 10. When they arrived in Jerusalem, Barnabas and Paul were welcomed by the whole church, including the apostles and elders. They reported everything God had done through them, but some of the believers who belonged to the sect of Pharisees stood up and insisted, "The Gentile converts must be circumcised and required to follow the law of Moses." So the apostles and elders met together to resolve this issue. And at the meeting, after a long discussion, Peter stood and addressed them as follows. "Brothers, you all know that God has chosen me from among you some time ago to preach to the Gentiles so that they can hear the good news and believe. God knows people's hearts, and he confirmed that he accepts Gentiles by giving them the Holy Spirit just as he did to us. He made no distinction between us and them, for he cleansed their hearts through faith. So why are you now challenging God by burdening the Gentile believers with a yoke that neither we nor our ancestors were able to bear?" May the Lord add his blessing to the reading of the word.
Electronics are wonderful. Before I begin my sermon, which is situated smack in the middle of this weekend, our lecture series weekend, I'm going to invite our guests for the weekend, Steve and Iyer, to come up, and let's talk just a little bit. When did you guys come to, you brought Seventh Gay Adventist, the film, to Auburn? And I think that's when I met you guys.
Yeah, that's when we met.
When was that? That's 5 years ago?
Yeah, it was a few years ago.
Yeah.
We've all kind of blurred together. We've done a few screenings over the years.
Yes.
So we've been working on this for a while.
All right, so how did you get started?
Yeah, so hello, everyone. I'm Stephen Iyer, and my wife, Denise Akers, would normally be here with me, but we have a one-year-old, one-and-a-half-year-old who's sick, so she's... we have an 8-year-old and a 1.5-year-old, but the 1-year-old is sick, and so...
I will just warn you that even when your children become old, they still have the capacity to rearrange your life. Yeah. I'm just warning you.
It's not just now.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it...
We started working in this area about 8 years ago.
Why?
And we were attending a small church in San Francisco. It was a church plant. And there were gay and lesbian members of that church. And I had grown up Adventist, you know, I'm fifth generation Adventist. And, you know, for me growing up, I didn't even realize you could be gay and Adventist.
Right, yeah.
Honestly, I just didn't even think like that was even possible. In fact, I didn't even realize there were gay Adventists when I was in high school. Turns out I have two close friends that were gay that I just didn't know about. And when Prop 8 came through California, this conversation started to happen within the church and within my community. And I just realized, Danine and I both realized we were pregnant with, or she was pregnant with Lily at the time, we were gonna have a baby, and we realized this needs, like we need to have a conversation about this, and this needs to be talked about. And so we set out on this crazy road trip to make a film when our daughter was 9 months old, and we came through Seattle, we went 10,000 miles around the United States, and we just realized Adventists, you know, need to have this conversation just like anybody else. And if we're going to have our daughter grow up in the church, what kind of church is that going to be? Is it going to be a loving church? Is it going to be a condemning church? So those were the questions kind of going through our minds when we started doing all of this. And now it's been like 8 years. So
the problem was you met an actual human being.
Yeah, I mean, that
sounds like.
You.
I mean, it sounds like that was a problem. Yeah, you ran into real live human beings that did not fit your
stereotype. Listen, we all know what the verses say. We've all read the clobber text. We know what the Bible says. So what happens when your experience is in conflict with what the teaching is? What do you do? How do you respond? And I couldn't justify treating these amazing people that I had come to know as anything less than fully human, fully divine, you know, with that same beautiful, you know, made in the image of God, a thing about them, like everybody else. And so I struggled with what to do about that. And so I thought the best thing to do was to make a movie. Because when you make a movie, you have to talk to a lot of people about it. And you have to process all of this. And so we went around and we interviewed many, many people. We set up these story booths and we just welcomed people in to take the time to hear their stories, and that transforms you. It's amazing what that will do when you take the time to listen. So we tried to do that. We tried to listen. And I think, you know, we all come at this from different places, and we're all kind of on a journey when we're trying to deal with what it means to respond to people that are different than us. And for me, I think, you know, I'm at a different place than where I used to be, but sometimes I realize, like, I need to be patient with those other people that are maybe just now getting to know gay and lesbian and bisexual and transgender and queer Adventists for the first time. I feel privileged to be able to bring those stories to the church and to challenge congregations to think about what would happen if you have a gay and lesbian member in your church, because you do, you just may not know about it, but you do. And if you don't, there's something going on there.
A real problem. Yeah. So tell us about the afternoon's film.
Okay, so far, for those of us that weren't, I'll try and get you caught up to where we're at in the series.
Okay, there you go.
So last night we did the screening of our first film, which is called Seventh Gay Adventist, and I realized that that is kind of a gut punch title, and it was originally going to be just kind of like a working title, but what happened was the gay and lesbian community that we were working with adopted it. Why? Because being gay and Adventist is an identity, and you don't rip that out of somebody. It's who that person is. So we did a screening last night of three stories, and It was a great conversation we had afterwards. I wanted to start with the stories because I think that's where we get to know people on an emotional level. This morning we had a great conversation with the Sabbath School group. We showed one of the short films that we're doing right now. We have a whole series called Outspoken, short documentaries. And the reason we're doing the short films is because we weren't able to cover every topic in the SGA film. For example, one of the films coming out soon is going to be on a transgender Adventist. And another one is going to be parents of gay and lesbian Adventists. And so those stories are not in Seventh Gay Adventists. Mm-hmm. So we're trying to supplement some of those things. But the film this afternoon is the film that really gets to, like, what Adventists love, which is the debate, right? We love to, like, debate. And we love to discuss, and we love to ask those hard questions, which we should be asking. How do you reconcile your experience of knowing somebody who's gay, an Adventist, and with what the Bible says? And what happens in a community when you have different perspectives on that and different interpretations of Scripture? How do you work together as a community to resolve some of those issues? So we brought together 12 people from across the United States with varying views. And we try and break down some of the common labels and stereotypes through that process. They didn't know who was going to be there for that weekend. They had to trust us. It turned out to be an amazing, amazing weekend, and I can't wait to share it with you guys so you can see what that was like. But we wanted that to be a model for congregations like Green Lake that might have people, that definitely have people, coming at this from different perspectives. How do we still understand this? How do we grow together? How do we create a congregation that truly lives out what you have on your website right now, being a safe territory for all people and a loving congregation for all people? And how do we move from just being tolerant to being loving and accepting? So That's the challenge, and that's what the film and conversation will be about this afternoon.
Thank you, Stephen. Yeah. Thanks for being here. You can keep the mic, take it with you, and turn it off. Yeah. I think Violet has ruined my sermon. I did not realize that we were going to have a youngster reading our scripture reading this morning. And when Violet realized what she had to read, she said to her mother, "That's not nice." I am reminded of our Wednesday Bible study. Pastor Mika is leading the study now on the Gospel of John. But a year or so ago, I was leading the Bible study, and we were in 1 Samuel, I think. And we came to some passages, and Linda Hybe would read this passage of Scripture, and she would rear back and go, it would be, you know, God said, go kill somebody or something. I mean, it, you know, God said. And Linda would go, that's not right. Linda was right. And Violet was right. If we are going to be faithful to God, there are times when we must push back against the ancient words. And I chose this morning's scripture to be the most, well, to be at least a dramatic statement in scripture that if you found yourself going, yes, amen, you are sick. You are, you're dangerous. Did you hear the words that were read? Idol worship is bad. Don't do it. And then, here's what I want you to do. Keep your ears open. And if you hear somebody hint that they might be open to idol worship, grab a rock and grab all your friends and kill them. Do this if it's your best friend. Do this if it's your kid. Do this if it's your spouse. If you can read those words and go, yeah, let's do that. Maybe we just keep a pile of rocks here in the church so that we're ready. If there is anything in you going, yeah, amen, I could get into that. You need some healing. What do you do with that text? It is in Scripture. It is part of our history as people of faith, and we are repulsed by it. And we should be. Faithfulness to God does not always mean obedience to the ancient word. That was dramatically illustrated in our New Testament reading this morning. Peter. Good old Peter. There was a big debate in the church. The early Christians were all Jewish people. Christianity was merely the purest, truest, brightest expression of the religion of Abraham. Christians were Jews. They merely understood themselves to be the very best Jews, recovering the absolute purity of the springs of their faith. And then Gentile people showed up. A bunch of them.
And the debate arose in the church. What about these people? Are they part of us? Some said, yeah, they're part of us. God clearly showed that they are part of us because God called them into the church. And others said, absolutely no way, because the scripture is clear. You cannot be part of the pure, true people of God unless you're circumcised. And they could cite chapter and verse. In the Old Testament, there are both in the books of Moses and later in the prophets, multiple passages that say, look, treat everybody the same. Foreigners, treat them the same or even better than you do the native born. And without apology, here we read those passages week after week after week. Don't draw these lines. Foreign born, native born, all the same. Except when it came to Passover. Nobody can participate in Passover unless they are circumcised. Not even a servant in a Jewish home could participate unless the servant was circumcised. The scripture was crystal clear. No ambiguity. Circumcision is absolutely required for full participation in the essential religious life of the Jewish people. And the Christians were the purest, highest, brightest expression of Judaism. Therefore, you couldn't lower the standards and let uncircumcised people in. So they have a big general conference, everybody debates, and finally Peter stands up and gives the speech we heard in our New Testament reading. And Elise, I will borrow your words. Peter said to the gathered religious leaders, stop it! He said, you're trying to impose on others a burden that we have not been able to carry ourselves. And God has already demonstrated his will because he gave them the Holy Spirit the same as he did to us. If God doesn't make a distinction, why would we? I want us to see as clearly as we can that when Peter stands up and says, let us welcome the Gentiles, let us let go of the requirement of circumcision, he does not cite scripture. When we, in today's world, talk about why Christians don't require circumcision, we run to the writings of Paul, and Paul developed a theology that supported getting rid of circumcision, and he quotes ancient texts. That was written after Peter's speech. That was written after the church had decided. Peter called for the church to make a firm, clear decision based on the clear present leading of God and the experience of God's people carrying the weight of being perfect law keepers. It had killed them. It was crushing them. It would crush. Why put on others a burden that we cannot carry ourselves? I argue, I have done so in print, and now I will do it from the pulpit, that it is time for us as a denomination And it is time for us as a congregation to let go of the ancient texts that we have used to exclude people that God has clearly included. And I say that not first because of a bunch of texts. I'm going to go to some texts in a minute. But those are like Paul's writings. It's the theology that I'm bringing to support something. A decision that I made long ago, and I was driven to it by story. I spent a year as the roommate of the most famous Adventist homosexual, a man who at that point was deep in the closet, and I did not have any idea. I was a kid. But near the end of my time there with him, he told me his story. He was a minister. And he told me of chasing all the ways of deliverance that have been promised. Prayer and fasting and psychotherapy and you name it. He had done everything in the universe he could find to try to lay hold of the goal that the church told him was the right goal. And it didn't work. But the church's urging was so strong that after he was outed and kicked out of ministry, he then went and tried more change therapy, and he changed. He became a heterosexual. He got married. He had children. He ran a change ministry. And through that whole time, was damaging young men. It doesn't work. And so I hold him accountable for some of the lives that he damaged, but far more, I hold us accountable. He went there because we drove him there. Let's stop driving. And instead, let's welcome. Let's not use the ancient text as a basis to exclude people that God has received and welcomed. Now, let's go to the text. How dare I say let go? First, because you've already done it. There is no one in this building that would read our Old Testament passage and do it. Not one of you. You wouldn't even be tempted to do it. You have already taken plain, clear words of Scripture and said, no. We've already done it in the places that were congenial for us. And I'm glad we did. I'm hoping you guys aren't. I hope you don't have piles of rocks under your pews. A story that I've told, I think, from this pulpit twice. It's in the Bible, the story of Joshua and the Gibeonites. God had clearly, emphatically, unambiguously, how many more adverbs do I need to add here? God said, destroy the Canaanites, all of them. The Gibeonites were Canaanites. They go, this is scary. What can we do? We will trick them. So the Gibeonites went to Joshua and said, we're not Canaanites. Would you make a treaty with us? Joshua said, you sure you're not a Canaanite? Yeah. Oh, no, we're not Canaanites. The Gibeonites presented an acceptable identity. And Joshua said, you're in. Then they found out that, in fact, the Gibeonites were Canaanites. Oh no, what do we do? What had God said to do? Kill them. What did Joshua's army say to do? Kill them. And what did Joshua say? Over my dead body. And why? Why did Joshua defy the word of God and protect these people who had tricked their way into the people of God? Joshua did it on the basis of ordinary human decency. He said, I gave him my word, I will not break it. If that makes me damned by God, I will be damned by God, but I will not be an indecent human being. I will not break my word. And later scripture explicitly says that God approved of Joshua's bold protection of these people. The parallel with our members who have non-regular gender or sexual identities is clear. We have children who grow up among us, and they're all so pretty, and they're all wonderful, and it's okay. And they get through high school and they get through college, and it's okay as long as we don't know. But then when we suspect that they have a non-traditional identity, we kick them out of our schools, we hound them out of our churches, and we drive them to suicide. That's not right. And we can do better. At our house, we violate the Adventist health law flagrantly for one of the little kids at our house. One of the little kids at our house, if he wants ice cream, we give him all the ice cream he wants. If we give him vegetables, we slather the vegetables in butter. They swim in butter. If we make cookies for him, we add extra coconut oil. When we make a peanut butter sandwich for him, we leave off the bread. Why? Because it's what he needs. He is dangerously underweight. The highest priority in his life for us is to get calories into him. So imagine, and this doesn't take too much work. I can imagine somebody explaining to me, your kid looks a little puny. Have you tried veganism? You know, I bet he just needs a little more broccoli. You know, you probably know people who would make those suggestions. Because a good Adventist diet is, you know, intense in vegetables and high fiber. And that's what normal people need, right? It will kill my grandson. As parents, as grandparents, we will bend the whole world to the need of our little one. As the Church of God, can we do any less?
Thank you.
Let's pray. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen.